divine intervention. Experiencing divine intervention. And our text is taken from Luke chapter 7. Luke chapter 7 from verse 11 to 17. Luke 7, 11 to 17. It says, soon afterwards, Jesus went to a town called Nain, and his disciples and a large crowd went along with him. As he approached the town gates, a dead person was being carried out, the only son of his mother, and she was a widow. And a large crowd from the town was with her. And when the Lord saw her, his heart went out to her, as I believe that the Lord will see someone in this service.
Amen.
And the Lord's heart will go towards you.
Amen.
In the name of Jesus.
Amen.
And when the Lord saw her, his heart went out to her, and he said, don't cry. And I see God telling somebody, don't cry.
Amen.
I see God telling somebody, don't worry.
Amen.
And then he went up and touched the coffin, and those carrying it stood still. And he said, young man, I say to you, get up. And the dead man sat up and began to talk, and Jesus gave him back to his mother. They were all filled with awe and praise God. A great prophet has appeared among us, they said. God has come to help his people. God will help someone here today.
Amen.
In the name of Jesus.
Amen.
So this news about Jesus spread throughout Judea and the surrounding country. Many times in life we come to certain seasons, certain periods and phases in our lives. We come against certain situations that demands divine intervention. We come to seasons in our life that we just demand and desire divine intervention. Like the story of this woman, all hope was lost completely. The physicians have tried, they couldn't help her. But at the last minute, God showed up, as God will show up for you.
Amen.
In the name of Jesus.
Amen.
The God that we serve is never too late.
Amen.
He is always on time, right on time.
Yes, Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
That's the God that we serve. He is always on time and right on time. So what is divine intervention? Let's just discuss that. Divine intervention can be God causing something to happen, or God preventing something from happening. So it's a two-way thing. God taking action to make something happen, or God taking action to stop a process from happening. In other words, God is intentionally involved. It's not, I am not sure God is involved. God is intentionally involved in a difficult situation in order to improve that situation or stop it or prevent it from getting worse. Why do we need divine intervention? When we are, number one, when we are weak, physically we are weak, spiritually we may be weak, we need divine intervention. Because when a man is weak physically and a man is weak spiritually, he has come to his wit's end. He's about to give up life completely. I saw on the internet recently a man who goes to one of the cliffs, either in South Korea or North Korea. He has a binocular with him. He hides under the rocks, the cliff of the rocks. And with the binocular, what he does is that he looks for someone who is about to jump from the cliff to die, to commit suicide. And so with the binocular, he could able to see them before they see him. And then he walked towards them and begin to tell them, You know, when somebody is about to commit suicide, he has given up hope completely. He has lost hope completely. There is nothing that is working. Everything is gone. His emotion, dead. All the enemy is putting to his head is, just end it. Just end it. And then when he hears a voice that says, so stop, he shocks and says, who sent you? And so that man, it's an old man. He has been able to rescue 600 people on that mountain. He doesn't do any other thing. He just sits there and waits for them. But you see, the God that we serve will not wait for you to get to the mountain. He will send someone to rescue you. In the name of Jesus. So a man becomes physically weak or spiritually weak when every hope is gone. So we need a divine intervention when we are weak. 2 Corinthians 12, 9 and 10 tells us. 2 Corinthians 12, 9 and 10. He said, and he said unto me, my grace is sufficient for thee, for my strength is made perfect in weakness. Most gladly, therefore, will I rather glory in my infirmity, that the power of Christ may rest upon me. So we need divine intervention. When you notice that your spiritual strength is going down, when you notice that your physical strength is going down, then you need divine intervention. Then we need divine intervention. And then we have to go to God so that the power of Christ may rest upon us. Number two, when do we need divine intervention? When we face situations that are beyond our comprehension. There are situations in life that are beyond our comprehension. You can't explain it. The doctors can't explain it. The professors can't explain it. Even the prophet is even struggling to explain it. Because it's not everything that they know. It's not everything the prophet knows. It's not everything the pastor knows. But we have a God that knows everything. Amen. Amen. When we are faced with situations that are beyond our comprehension, let's look at, for example, 1 Kings chapter 3. 1 Kings chapter 3, verse 16 to 18. 1 Kings 3, 16 to 18. It's a story that every time I read that story, I realize that it can only be God who was able to tell Solomon the answers. And it's a story of divine wisdom, making a wise decision in a situation that is beyond comprehension. And you know the story. And let's look at it together. It says, one day two women who were prostitutes came to Solomon. As they stood before him, one of the women said, my master, this woman and I live in the same house. I gave birth to a baby while she was there with me. 3 days later, this woman also gave birth to a baby. No one else was in the house with us. It was just two of us. One night, this woman rolled over on her baby and he died. So she took my son from my bed during the night while I was asleep, and she carried him to her bed. Then she put the dead baby in my bed. The next morning, when I got up to feed my baby, I saw that he was dead. When I looked at him more closely, I realized it wasn't my son. No, the other woman cried. The living baby is my son, and the dead baby is yours. But the first woman said, no, the dead baby is yours, and the living one is mine. So the two women argued before the king. Verse 23. Then King Solomon said, one of you says, my son is alive and your son is dead. The other one says, no, your son is dead and my son is alive. Then the king sent his servant to get a sword. Based on the facts, the evidence presented before the king, he cannot determine who owns the baby. He cannot determine. Unfortunately, at this time, there was no physical DNA test to check whose DNA is the baby carrying. But you see, brethren, we have a spiritual DNA. That's what we call a spiritual DNA. And a spiritual DNA, which is called divine wisdom, has the ability to decode even the Da Vinci code. Praise God.
Hallelujah.
Divine wisdom. It can decode any genome. It can decode anything, divine wisdom. I know that we define wisdom as the right application of knowledge. But you see, sometimes you have the facts, you have the knowledge, but you can't decode it. But divine wisdom is decoding with divine understanding. It's applying divine knowledge. But look at the story of Solomon. And this is where I picked that thought from. He said, the king said to his servant, get a sword. And when they brought it to him, he said, cut the living baby into two pieces and give each woman half based on the fact before him. That is what he should do in order to ensure that at least one person gets one part. So nobody will say the king was wicked and gave everything up. But guess what? This is where the divine wisdom came in. And when But the other woman said, the real mother of the living child was what? Was full of love for her son. And so she said to the king, please, my master, don't kill him. Give the baby to her. But the other woman said, neither of us will have him. Cut him into two pieces. And then the king Solomon said, don't kill him. Give the baby to the first woman because she is the real mother. Brethren, true love speaks. True love covers. True love overcomes. True love can take insults. True love can enable you to stand where others have failed. True love can give you what others think that it's beyond you. Because at this point in time, the love from mother's heart yelled out for this son. And the king was wise enough to take notes because of divine wisdom that the love of the mother is the one crying out at this point in time. No more emotions. And so he said, give the baby to the right mother. I see God giving you and I divine wisdom. In situations that seems difficult in life, difficult to comprehend, God will give us divine wisdom to be able to comprehend it.
Amen.
In the name of Jesus.
Amen.
James chapter 1 verse 5 says, but if any of you lacks wisdom, let him ask of God, who gives to all liberally without reproach. It will be given to him. Is there anyone here today who tests for divine wisdom today to unravel a mystery in your life or the life of others? God will grant to you that wisdom today.
Amen.
In the name of Jesus.
Amen.
You know, sometimes in life things are happening to us, we can't explain it, but when we face God and go to God and say, Lord, I want to understand what's going on with my life, then God releases wisdom to you for you to be able to decode what's going on. Number three, when do we need divine intervention? When we are faced with humanly impossible situations. The Bible says in Luke chapter 18 verse 27, the things which are impossible with men are possible with God. And we see a story in the Bible, the voyage of Paul to Rome, in Acts chapter 27 from verse 8 to 44. We won't read the whole of that. But I just speak some scriptures in verse 18, Acts 27, 18 to 20. It says, and as we labored, you know the story, Paul was sent to prison. He was on his way to Rome. And he died in Rome eventually. And that's why you have the Basilica Church in Rome. That's what they told us about historians, that they buried Paul there. So his sepulcher is there. So that was his last voyage. And was to appear before the ruling authorities there to defend his faith. Eventually, God gave him victory. But on the way, he had problems. And the problem was that the voyage was becoming difficult. You know, in those days, there was no flight. You travel by voyage. In other words, by the ship or whatever they call it. And at this point in time, it was becoming so difficult that they lost hope. Let's read the Bible. And as we labored, Acts 27, 18 to 20, as we labored exceedingly with the storm, the next day, they began to throw things overboard. On the third day, they threw out the ship's tackle with their own hands. When neither sun nor stars shone on us for many days, and no small tempest pressed on us, all hope that we should be saved was now taken away. In other words, all hope to be saved was now lost. And then Paul said this in 23, "For there stood by me this night an angel belonging to the God whose I am and whom I serve, saying, don't be afraid, Paul, you must stand before Caesar. Behold, God has granted you all those who sail with you." That's an example when we are faced with humanly impossible situation. We need divine intervention. At this point in time, Paul needed and his counterpart needed divine intervention. And God came to their rescue. God will come to your rescue in Jesus' name. Amen. Also in Exodus 14, if you read it, the Red Sea encounter, Exodus 14, 16 says, "Lift up your rod and stretch out your hand over the sea and divide it. And the children of Israel shall go into the midst of the sea on dry ground." This miracle has never happened before. And I see God doing in your life a miracle that nobody has ever experienced before. Amen. In the name of Jesus. Amen. You'll be the first person to testify that kind of miracle. Amen. In the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Number four, when do we need a divine intervention? When we are at a loss as to what to pray, either for ourselves or for our loved ones or for others. When we are at a loss, you know, sometimes you get to, I don't know if you have experienced it, you just get to a point that you have the same prayer point you have prayed for about 3 weeks. The same prayer point. You have prayed it over and over. And it's becoming to be wearisome. At those points in time, there is an antidote to it. The Holy Spirit is there to guide us. And it says that in Romans 8, 26 to 27, Romans 8, 26 to 27, says, "In the same way, the Spirit also helps our weaknesses. For we do not know how to pray as we ought. But the Spirit himself makes intercession for us with groanings which cannot be uttered. He searches the heart, knows what is on the Spirit's mind, because he makes intercession for the saints according to the will of God." And so if you're a believer and you don't have the Holy Ghost baptism, you are only subchanging yourself. You need the Holy Spirit to be able to pray effectively. You pray in your understanding, you pray in your understanding. When we are at that point whereby we have lost as to what to pray, either for ourselves, then this is the way out. Through this intervention, God takes us to a higher dimension. Praise God. Amen. When the storms of life comes up raging suddenly, just like as it happened to the disciples, even though Jesus was with them in the boat, they cried out to Jesus for help in Mark chapter 4, verse 39. Then he arose, Jesus arose and rebuked the wind and said to the sea, "Peace be still." And the wind ceased and there was a great calm. I believe God for someone here today. As you cry out to Jesus today, no matter how raging the storms of life may be at you, there shall be calmness. Amen. In the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Number five, when do we need divine intervention? When we encounter people whom we may find very difficult to love. When we encounter people whom we may find very, very difficult to love, we need divine intervention. God expresses his unconditional love through us. 1 John 4:7 tells us, 1 John 4:7 says, "Beloved, let us love one another, for love is of God. And everyone who loves is born of God and knows God." When it is difficult to love somebody, if I ever say extremely difficult, you have tried everything that's written in the books of love. You have tried everything and it's not working. those points in time. It's not the time to say, okay, to your tent, O Israel. That's not the time. It's the time to switch over to the Lord. Allow the Lord to intervene. Praise the Lord.
Amen.
There was a story of a man who was not wasn't a believer. So he came to church because he wanted to get married. And he got married. He got married to his sister. So after the wedding was over, then they got to the house. The guy said to the lady, "See, the reason why I came to church is to pick a wife. I am not born again. So you do your church thing, I do my own thing. I just needed a God-fearing woman. For me, I am not interested in being a Christian." And so the lady would go to church and come back, and it got to the point that he barred her from going to church. And then she went to her pastor. I said, "Pastor, this is my situation. What do I do?" The pastor said, "Respect your husband. If he says don't go to church, don't go to church. But while you are at home, fellowship with the Holy Spirit. Pray. And as you are praying, mention his name. Before he comes back from work, make sure his food is ready. Put his water. You know, in those days, there's no end suits. So the bathroom is a distance away from the main house. So go put his water that's going to take his bath in the bathroom. Just treat him nice. Treat him nice. Respect him. If he says sit down, sit down. If he says stand up, stand up. Before he comes, rush at the door. Say, oh, honey, welcome. Can I take your shoes off? I know if I recommend that one now to the ladies here, they say, Pastor, what are you turning us into? But the lady obeyed. And one day, the man was coming back drunk. And of course, when he comes back drunk and the lady is sleeping and he wants to exercise his due benevolence. You know what I mean by due benevolence? Yeah? Do you know what I mean by due benevolence?
Yes.
Who said no? Ask those that are in the windows. And he would just, you know, do it without the man's, without the woman's consent, you know, like that. And there'll be some bleeding here and there. But yet, she was faithful. She was faithful. She was faithful to the call. Amen? She was faithful to the call. And then at the end of the day, one day, she was praying, and the man came. And as the man came, the man heard his name being mentioned. And the woman was agonizing the prayer, saying, "Lord, you know I love my husband. It doesn't matter what he is doing to me, I still love him. He is the one that you have given to him. I have no thing in my heart against him. I love him. Please, Lord, bless him." At that point, it became clear to the man that his days of being unbeliever was over. Because he just knelt down and said, "Look, my dear, can you please pray for me? I want to give my life right now." So sometimes it is not tit for tat that wins the battle. Love does greater works than force. Praise the Lord. So when it is difficult to love people, just go to God, ask him for grace. Because Romans 5:5 tells us that the love of God has been shed abroad in our heart by the Holy Spirit. So the love is there already. The seed is there. It's just for us to fan it and develop it. Praise God. So what are the keys to experiencing divine intervention? Number one key to experience divine intervention is an exchanged life. An exchanged life. Galatians chapter 2 verse 20 tells us, it says, "I have been crucified with Christ. It is no longer I that live, but Christ living in me. That life which I now live in the flesh, I live by faith of the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me." In other words, Paul was telling us that the life that you and I are living right now, because we are born again children of God, it is not our own life. We are living because Christ lives in us. Praise the Lord. So for us to engage and have divine intervention, the first thing we need to do is to have an exchanged life. When Christ takes over our life, when Christ is in control of our life, then our life will now begin to have a new meaning.
Amen.
Praise the Lord.
Amen.
Our life will begin to have a new meaning. And Christ will take us to a dimension that we never thought that was possible before. Praise God.
Amen.
I am a living witness. It's a privilege always to stand before you. I don't take it for granted at all in any way. Because I am not worthy to stand here and talk about Jesus. I am not worthy. Because not only persecuted the Christians as well, I did more evil than any of you sitting here. And so when I became born again, I realized that the life I live now is for Christ. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
I know somebody said you are a pastor because you have a past. So if you have a past sitting there, you too will become a pastor. Hallelujah.
Yeah.
So when Christ takes over our life, or he's in control of our life, he takes us our life to a new dimension. A new dimension that we never thought was possible. Look at Paul, for example. Look at Paul. You know the story of Paul. In 2 Corinthians 12:7. It was an exciting story about Paul. Paul impacted his world. 2 Corinthians 12:7. He had abundance of revelation. The revelation Paul had was too much to explain. Up till now, Paul has died many years, but up till now, Paul is still speaking. There is no sermon any pastor will preach that Paul will not say a word.
Yes, sir.
The abundance of revelation. Why? Because he recognized that the life that he was living was not his own life, but Christ was living in him. Praise God. Number two key is undying love for God. Undying love for God. Deuteronomy 6:5 says, you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your might. In other words, love motivates us to honor God at all times. Love motivates us to honor God at all times and seasons of our lives, no matter the challenges. And I love that scripture, which I was meditating one day. It says, Song of Solomon 8:7 says, many waters cannot quench love. Many waters cannot quench love. It doesn't matter the circumstances I am facing, my love for God will not dwindle. I will not relinquish my love for Christ for the material gains of this world. Many waters cannot quench love. And the Lord expects us to love Him with all of our heart, with all of our soul, with all of our might. And I see somebody, the boys in the book of Daniel, they demonstrated this. And God showed up in Daniel chapter 3 from verse 17 to 18. It's an interesting story. Every time you want to renew your commitment, you want a scripture that will challenge your commitment of loving God. A scripture that will examine your own love for God. Go to this story. The three Hebrew boys, they said to the king, "King, we are not careful to address you in this matter. We have a God that we serve. We are Jews. We can't bow down to a foreign God. And so we have a God that we serve. But even if this God that we serve is not coming to deliver us, so be it. But let it be recorded in heaven that there are three boys who loved God to the end. And the truth of the matter is that God is looking forward for people who will love Him to the end. Because every time God finds a lover, oh my God, He uses you as a showcase to the world. And that's what happened to these boys. Today we are talking about them. And the king was so angry, and he said, look, hit the flame 7 times. And the Bible recorded that the men who bound them to throw them into the fire were slain by the flames. And not only that, when they landed, they were bound when they entered the flame. But when they touched ground, they were set loose.
Hallelujah.
And there was a fourth man in the fire. For the first time, the laws, the physical laws of fire was disapproved. For the first time, fire consumes. It says furnace is for gold. The blacksmith's fire is for the silver's dross. In other words, you don't put silver in the furnace, it will evaporate. But when you need pure metal like gold, you put it in the furnace. So fire has a tendency to purify. But then, when fire is purifying, it's consuming certain things off. So for the first time in the physical law, fire failed to consume the materials that they were wearing. Why? We serve a God who can intervene in any situation.
Amen.
Provided that we show him that we love him. Number four, the prevailing prayer. The prevailing prayer. And this is the bedrock of why we pray in Calvary Lost City. In Exodus 17, 8 to 13, Exodus 17, 8 to 13, verse 9 says, "And Moses said unto Joshua, choose us out men, and go out and fight with Amalek. Tomorrow I will stand on the top of the hill with the rod of God in my hand." And in verse 10, "So Joshua did as Moses had said to him, and fought with the Amalek. And Moses, Aaron, and Hur went up to the top of the hill." Look at verse 11. "And it came to pass, when Moses held up his hand, that Israel prevailed. And when his hand was down, Amalek prevailed." What law is that? What principle is that? When the man of God was praying for his people, they were prevailing. And when his hands were down, they were losing. Now that tells you something. If you are a Christian, you must have a pastor. You must have somebody who is your man of God, who will intercede for you. Because if it's by physical strength, Joshua wouldn't have been able to prevail. What does that tell us? Let's look at verse 12. "But Moses' hands were heavy," because he's a man. He's not a ghost. He's a man. "And they took a stone and put it under him, and he sat thereon. And Aaron and Hur stayed up his hand, one on each side. And as his hands were steady until the going down of the sun, Joshua discomfited the Amalek and his people with the edge of the sword." In other words, life battle can always be won in the place of prayer. Life battles can always be won in the place of prayer. Victory is a function of the believer coming before God and seeking his face. Victory is not a measure of your physical strength. Victory is not a measure of your intellectual knowledge and know-how. Victory is a measure of a believer knowing that there is a God I can call upon, and this God will respond to him. Praise the Lord. That's why the Bible says in Proverbs 21:31, says the horse is prepared against the day of battle, but safety or victory is of the Lord. Therefore, spending time alone with God equips us with all the necessary tools we need to overcome every issue of life. Because the more we spend time with God, God gives us insight on how and what to do to overrun the enemy. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Why? You have to go to God. The Bible says that the name of the Lord is what? Is a strong tower. And the righteous run into it, and they are what?
Saved.
They are saved. In other words, when you run to the Lord in the place of prayer, the Lord that you have run into, there is no situation that is new to God. None. He is the Alpha and the Omega and everything in between. In other words, God foresees what the enemy is about to do. Every trap, every snare, every temptation, he foresees it. He knows it. And what he will do, he will orchestrate your feet, orchestrate your life in such a way that you navigate above the traps of the enemy.
Amen.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
That's the God we serve. And that's why prayer is critical to a Christian. Critical. Highly critical. And lastly, have faith in God. That's the fourth key. Have faith in God. Faith is a spiritual force that causes something that would not ordinarily happen to happen. Faith brings God into the affairs of men, resulting into miracles, signs, wonders, testimonies, incredible works, strange acts of God. Faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. By it, the elders obtain a good report. If they obtain the good report, the principle is the same. You will also obtain a good report.
Amen.
You will obtain a good report.
Amen.
In the name of Jesus.
Amen.
And I love this scripture. Even Jesus said to us in Mark 11:22, says, have faith in God. Have faith in God. Have faith in God. Have faith in God. Why? When you find a man of faith, a man of faith is a man whose focus is on God. Why? Because the faith will allow him to focus on God, not on the circumstances that surround him. That's what faith does. Faith is about looking up to God. Your focus is on God, not on the circumstances around, not on the frightening circumstances or situations that are worrying or bothering you. You need not fret. Have faith in God. Psalm 112 verse 7 says, he shall not be afraid of evil tidings. His heart is fixed, trusting in the Lord. You see, faith is the opposite of fear. When you trust God, you don't have fear. Even if the earth be removed, we shall not be shaken. Faith comes when we listen to the voice of God, when we read the word of God. When we are in an assembly of this nature, the word of God is coming. Faith is being accompanied. Praise the Lord.
Yeah.
And you know, like we do here, that faith is the currency for receiving anything from God's kingdom.
Amen.
That's the currency. There's no pounds in heaven. And there's no Japanese yen or American dollars in heaven.
Yes, sir.
They can't go beyond the material level. So the currency of trafficking is faith.
Amen.
If God finds a man with faith, he performs whatever the request is.
Oh, yes.
Praise God.
Hallelujah.
I see God intervening in your situation today.
Amen.
In the name of Jesus.
Amen.